If you've never been in here before, that is Dobie Weasel. That's who he is. An ancient Native American name. Be careful for the tribe of Weasel, for they are powerful. God bless you. I have been with Dobie many times at Promise Keepers. We've had a great time. We've done wonderful things, and now we are here with you guys in Omaha, Nebraska, Sunday morning. Where else would I want to be? I have been all around the world. I've been everywhere, London, Paris, France. I've been on television, but now, Omaha. Woo! My career is skyrocketing, ladies and gentlemen. When I think London, Paris, New York, I think Omaha, lady. Come on in, we got a show. Come on in. Come on in. She's like scared to death. What is happening? This is my second time in the church. She's already calling me out. What's going on? I hate this church. You better not. You're part of this experience of Nebraska. I love coming to Nebraska because Nebraska is middle America. I love middle America because you still remember the standards and the concepts that made this American country and this great experiment work. You developed the ideas, the agriculture, the ideas of what would allow us to be self-sustaining in a democratic republic unlike anything on the face of the earth. And let me tell you why else I love coming to Nebraska, because you hunt, you fish, and you don't apologize for it. And that's why I love coming here. Oh, I'm so sick of this politically correct. Don't shoot the animals. They might get their feelings hurt. This is Nebraska. You don't even pretend to be animal rights activists. You people are like, see the bunny, shoot it, eat it, make a hat. Out of the hat's a cute bunny. Yeah, that sure was. Is that a snake? No, that's a boot right there. Put that on it. That's America. Shoot it, eat it. You got a head left over, hang it on your wall. That's who we are. Farm community. That's who you are. This guy came in fatigues, for crying out loud. I know that because I can only see half of his body. It's like jeans and then a bush. Some guy's hiding in a bush in the front row. And I'm glad you have your fatigues, because I am assuming you believe in the Second Amendment. Good. I'm glad you do. I heard an ooh, Pastor. I heard an ooh. This isn't a church service. This is a comedy show. I get to talk back. Just to forewarn you, because I believe in the First Amendment, too. The original founding fathers who said the first line in the First Amendment, Congress shall make no law establishing a religion. It has never done that, Pastor Dobie, or forbidding the free exercise thereof. It's done that every day. We must speak about what we believe in. That's what makes us great. That's why when I come to Nebraska, I talk about Nebraska stuff. Like you hunting fish. So what? That's a good thing. That's a beautiful thing. But I got to tell you, I can't drive here. You guys must be the greatest drivers on the face of the earth. You have to be great drivers. You know why I know that? Because things happen to you on your roads I've never seen before. Things happen to you on your roads that I thought only happened to pilgrims and pioneers. I'm not used to that because I learned to drive in L.A. People think L.A.'s hard. L.A.'s easy. 8 billion miles of freeways, one sign, maximum speed, 65. Good luck. Go! Not in Nebraska. You have way too many signs on the freeways. And they're never helpful signs. They're always warning me about something that's about to go wrong. Weird ideas that I'm just not used to as a city boy, and I give you credit because you've adapted as Americans who believe in the idea of adaptation to the surroundings therein. I give you credit. I'm not used to a sign warning me about an animal that might leap out. Get a zoo, for crying out. First time I saw deer crossing, like, why do you let them on? If you have deer jumping out on the road, that's not put up a sign problem. Let's put up a wall. Dig a moat. Get a fence. You know what? They invented barbed wire. Use it. You guys got deer jumping out on the road. You act like that's normal. Yeah, it's normal if you live in a cartoon. What do they do? Jump out in top hats?
Hello, my baby. Hello, my honey.
Dancing deer. And then you have the weird signs. The cold weather signs. Written in some cryptic shorthand apparently only Nebraskans can decipher. Bridge ice is before road. I'm like, okay. What do I do? Where's the rest of the information? You guys are passing. I got heat on, snowshoes, a walrus. Help me! The bridge is gonna do something. Look out for deer. My favorite one, watch out for tractors. I'm no farmer, mind you, but don't they have like a designated, I don't know, field they're supposed to be in? Nebraska farmers just run wild periodically. Party! Hey, Clem, grab a combine. Let's go on the freeway. Slow down. Got this baby up to 3. Let's go race the Amish. Come on. Is that on? That's right. When all else fails, make fun of the Amish. Why? Because they have no electronic recording equipment to prove I said anything. And if they did, they couldn't plug it in. You want to know you're going slow when an Amish guy behind you is going, come on! That's slow. But it's Nebraska. You've adapted to your environment. You've got these beautiful, amazing cities and then suddenly rural farmland. You've adapted to your environment. You are Americans. You deal with what it is. You make the best out of what it is. You redeem culture. You look at the wheat and the corn and you grow it. You call yourself corn huskers. You could have called yourself anything. It's your nickname. You could have been beef makers, steak producers, tillers of the land. What did you choose? Well, we can peel corn really good. We are corn huskers. That was your choice. That was your call. God bless you. Why? Because you care about grain. You care about the provisions God provides. That's why I said when you come through this area, it's different for me because of the farm community, which I love. I'm not used to it. You gave me a new sign. That's what I wanted to tell you. You gave me a new sign. I was actually driving down your little area and saw a sign that said, bump. Said, bump with an arrow, show me where the bump's gonna be. Now, I'm no professional when it comes to the best use of county funds for road repair, but I'm thinking if you got enough money to build a bump sign, got enough excess money to hire people to install bump signs, here's an idea. Fix the bump! Maybe it's time to take money out of the bump sign slush fund and apply it to the bump repair pork barrel legislation. Why? Because they don't work. See, I believe signs are important because they're supposed to communicate true information, and they don't work. See, a sign should warn you about what's coming so you can avoid it. Here's how a bump sign went. Bump. I don't like that. I don't want to be going 90s in a giant hole, huh? Bunch of Nebraska guys in red vests. What's the problem? We put up a sign. least you missed the bump. Hey, can you hand me that Amish guy? He's been down there a week and a half. Can you give him to me? Signs should warn you about what's coming. They should tell you what is true so you can make good observations. They should be true. Driving through Nebraska, I find that ironic. I think I found the best waste of taxpayer money, driving your freeways. It's your investment in speed limit signs. First off, when it comes to the word limit, all bets are off. Just get rid of that one. Just speed. Because that's what's happening. I had the audacity to get in the fast lane. What the fast lane means in Nebraska is get out of the way! This is the fast lane! That means you have to be going faster than me! Guy was mad at me, had kids in the back. Look at this idiot, kids, going 60 at a 60. Signs should mean what they say. I saw one that said, no, I counted them, 12 deer crossing signs, which I find ironic because I counted 13 dead deer. Had they been deer tried crossing, deer took a shot, but they're dead. Didn't make it. But that's what they are, signs. And they're supposed to tell us what is coming. Signs of the times. Signs of who we are, where we're going, what we're all about. And part of that is what God does. He shows he's here, but you get to choose to see him or not. You get to make the call. God is such a gentleman that as he reveals himself, he gets to allow you to say, I don't believe this is you. You get to choose. Did that thing that happened to you yesterday, was that providence or an accident? You get to choose. Was that a miracle or just a coincidence? You get to choose. Because God's involved in every element of your life. Every bit. And he allows you to experience all of your humanity through that. Why do I know that? Because we've been doing it already for 10 minutes. For 10 minutes in a church service where you're used to just a wonderful speaker and a wonderful pastor speaking of your ideas through the Bible. Instead, we've had a different form of worship. We've laughed. I believe laughter is a gift from God. I believe that God is constantly here every second of every moment, and he's always given us shadows and echoes of who he is and where he's at, but you have to choose to see it. And laughter is one of those things, because folks, I got a flash for you. In the entire gigantic universe, the only thing that laughs is people. Okay? Sun doesn't laugh. Flowers don't laugh. Animals don't laugh. That's why we eat them. You frown, you're going down. That's just the deal. No chuckle, belt buckle. We had to make a call. There was a hierarchy of how life would be if you choose to see it. There was a way about how creation was supposed to work if you choose to see it. Or you can choose to just change ideas based on culture. Either God is real and made the natural law, or we get to just make up our own rules. That's the choice. It matters what you believe about God. It has ramifications and repercussions. You have to go find God because he says, I'm never moving. You better come find me. Ask, seek, knock. Come find me. I'm right here, but you got to do some work. There is discipline to become a disciple. And it's not for everybody. It's not for everybody. So we're going to go talk about that for a minute. God, most powerful three-letter word of all time, God. Why? Because in that decision about believing in God or not will affect every decision you will ever make for the rest of your life. If you believe in God, then he's the rule maker. You got to figure out what he wants me to do, whether I like it or not, because he makes the rules. If you don't believe in God, you make up your own rules, and that works great unless somebody has a different rule and a gun. Because without an immutable truth, culture that's more powerful can destroy you. So we need God's ideas. We got to go find him. He's not easy to find. Not easy! Got to go search him out. Got some young people up here. They know what I'm talking about. How old are you, young lady? You're right there. Look at her, panicking. I don't believe this. How old are you? 12. Mm-hmm. It's not her fault. This poor girl was raised in a television computer generation. She's looking at me going, make him go away. Make him go away. He's speaking to me. Something's wrong. We got to go find God, I said, sweetheart. But how do you find him? You got to go find him, and it's not easy. You got to use big words sometimes. Big words. The kind of words you find in books, 12. 12's confused. I've read about books on the internet. In order to find God, you got to seek him. You got to use big words, not lazy words. We have a lot of lazy words coming on in this country. Lazy words, but people don't want to study, don't want to think, don't want to deal with anything. Just give me a sound bite, and that's all I need. Just give me a sound bite, that's all I need, so I don't have to think, so I don't have to change, I don't have to be disciplined, so I don't have to take my character and allow it to conform to God's will. Let me just let culture describe me so I don't have any problems. I got a very, very, very bad news for you guys. If your Christianity doesn't cause someone to hate you, it ain't Christian. What? But I thought hate was wrong. It is wrong. But Jesus promised this. They will hate what I have to say. They will hate it. They hated me first. Then they're going to hate you because you believed me. There is a cost for serving Christ. And that cost means we have to take everything else that we use to identify ourselves and sacrifice it for the sake of Christ. And that's not easy. Look at the people. What does that have to do with 12-year-olds? Because we got to use big words sometimes to find God. He's a big guy. Not the lazy words. I got people in this country so lazy they want to use words without letters. They just use a sound with a downward lilt. You've heard of him. Want one of those? Mm-mm. What? They find saying a two-letter word, no, too difficult. You want one of those? Mm-mm. Mm-mm. If you do want one, same sound, upward lilt. Want one of those? Mm-hmm. Don't even have to open their mouth. Want one? Mm-mm. Want one? Mm-hmm. Want one? Mm-mm. Want one? Mm-hmm. Not sure. Take the same sound, run it down the middle. Want one of those? I just said, and you knew what I meant. Lazy words. God demands discipline. Got to study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed. You would be ashamed, says God, if you don't study these things. Ashamed. Anybody making you ashamed anymore for not understanding your faith? No, not in America, Christianity. We want safety. You want easy Jesus. Jesus loves everybody. There's no rules anymore. He just loves us all. There's no redemption anymore. No forgiveness anymore, because why would you need forgiveness if you never have a sin? Why would you need redemption if God loves everything you do? What have we become? Because God demanded you become the trumpet for culture and say, here's the truth of God. And instead we've allowed the culture to trumpet us. Let us be conformed into our image. Do whatever we say. You church, enjoy yourself, but stay out of the public. Don't be bringing your stuff to us. Just stay in your little church service and leave us alone. That ain't America. It ain't First Amendment. It ain't liberty. But what do I say? What does that mean about God? What's he like? If I got to find him, what's he like? Sometimes you find out things about God you're not going to want to hear. Because you got to listen to him. There's things you need to know about God. Number one, God is a guy. Got a couple of women laughing. The men are like going, dear, may I laugh as well at that one? I'm not sure. Sweetheart, may I engage in, no? Because she's giving them that, don't you dare. Except for the men married over 30 years, they got a callus here. They don't feel any. God's a guy. How do we know that? How can you possibly say that? Well, because we look at the scriptures. He always calls himself Father. And up until the year 2012, that was considered a dude. Who thought that was going to get complicated? How else do we know God's a guy? Because everything he invented, he said, was good. And this is before duct tape, I might add. If God had used duct tape, he would use a real duck. He's God. How else do we know God's a guy? Because he worked hard for 6 days and then took a nap. On Sunday, so he could watch the game. And how do I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that God Almighty is a guy? Because he invented women. And they were naked. Only a guy would have come up with that one. I'm thinking it's just... We got some Southern Baptists that snuck in. I don't believe he said naked in church. He said naked in church. I'm trying to have a good thought life, and now I've got naked people stuck in my head. All I can picture is naked people dancing through tulips and ivy. Everywhere I go is naked people. Why is that in my head? And God said it was good. It was good. In the beginning, it was good. It was perfect. It was just the way it's supposed to be. God designed it that way. As a matter of fact, God said that until woman was created, until then, he said, and only after then did he say, it's very good. The completion of the universe was woman. Yeah, you should be excited. I know it. And it's exciting. Got some young boys right there. I said, because all the older men were going, very interesting, theological. Got the 10-year-old boy with a smile going to the back of his head. He'd say, tell me more of this Genesis. And the women therein. See, he's in church and he didn't know that you could say things like that. It's in the Bible. If the church doesn't tell who and why God created humanity, then who's going to? I know, the school system. That's who's teaching us now. Because we had the audacity to take the beautiful sacred covenant that God Almighty gave to humans and say it's too embarrassing to speak about. And so we have kids here that don't know what's going down instead of being in church and going, here's the sacred covenant that God demands. God said they were naked and it was good, and I got a flash for you, 12-year-old son, it's still good. And I got good news, God's still handing out naked ladies. But they're very expensive. Here's what God demands. You want one when you get older and become a man? Of course you do. You were designed that way, son. Here's what he demands. Marry her. never, ever, ever divorce. Commit your life to her, defend, honor, protect, and provide for that girl until you die. If you are a man willing to pay that price for the exotic Venus that God gave to us, you can have one, he said. And if you are not expecting that from a man in your life, my sisters, you do not care about yourself nearly as much as God Almighty does. There's a price. There's a price. God said he made man from the dirt. Made us from the dirt, but then he did something unique in the universe. He breathed life into his nostrils and he became a living soul. At that moment, he was like God. He gets to make other people. He gets to look at the universe and contemplate it. He gets to think ahead and behind. He gets to take creation and build from it. He gets to build cities. He gets to take the environment and try to deal with things. God said, go create, procreate. Go be like me. I'm in charge. I run it all, but go be like me. Be in fellowship with me. That's what God said. It's okay. Redeem it. Make it good. He made you unique, but we were alone. We needed her. And he pulled from our rib and he fashioned a womb man. From man's womb she came. That's right. Men were the first ones to give birth. Then we stepped back, observed our handiwork, and said, okay, ladies, you can take it from here. I'm going to go watch the game. There was a price. A price, God said, a woman is worth. A price, God said, a man's character is worth. But if we don't pay that price and allow the culture to dictate what is moral and true, then we have thrown the price away. We've lost our faith. The most difficult idea I've come across is when God said, I would rather you be cold or hot. I would rather you go to hell than abuse the grace I gave you. Get in or get out. We don't want to hear that in church. And by the way, God said, if you abuse my son's grace, the death that I paid for your price, you want to abuse that, you still get in, but it makes me puke. God said that, not me. We in America don't treasure the liberty of our faith. You know who does? Chinese Christians. Middle Eastern Christians, Christians in the Sudan, Christians in parts of Indonesia where they are butchered for their faith. And they don't walk away from it. It's worth that much. If you're not willing to die for your faith, you don't have it. Because God said, you are my slave. You have been bought with a price. You're not yours anymore. You're mine. If I want you to die, you die. If I want you to preach, you preach. If I want you to move forward, you move forward. If I want you to have to endure hardship for the sake of the cross, that's the deal. And if you don't want to pay that price, get out. That's what he said. Why don't we say it? Because it fearfully makes us think we might lose parishioners. I tried desperately to pray to God to anoint me when I speak because I want to help my people. And I always feel like I'm on the edge of not knowing where I'm going or what I'm doing. I understand, sir. Goodbye. Thank you so much. Well, we've lost one, but the rest of you are still here, and that's good news. You see, my brothers and my sisters, I never know what I'm going to say when I hit a stage. I only know ideas I want to discuss because I believe that God has used me as a comedian to talk about things in my country in this time, in this place, that must be said. And it's because I was a comedian that I was on Fox and Friends every Monday morning for 6 months, not because I was a pastor. It was because I was a comedian that New Yorker did an article on me, not because I was a pastor. I'm not saying that to brag. I'm saying that because the package God gave me to deliver this message allowed me into places that we aren't accepted anymore. That's the deal. I heard, I went. You think I don't pay a price? And I said I'd pay. I really believe Jesus is God. I'm a slave. That's a loaded word in this country. Because there's some of this country is built off the backs of slaves. It's a black eye in the culture of America. Because people who did not want to leave their country and their ideas were forced to. And yet God said, you come to me, you willingly become a slave. Everything that you thought was you, your color, your race, your ethnicity, goes to the cross. You now are a follower of Christ. What I say goes. I don't care what your history is. Use it. Use your history to teach us. Use your experiences to learn and grow. But you're not yours anymore. You're bought with a price. That's what we are. That's what allows this beautiful congregation of many, many ethnicities to come together. Because you actually believe that Christ rules you, not the culture. You've done what we were supposed to do. You mixed it up. Good for you. I want to tell you my story. I don't normally do this, but I have to quickly tell you. The first time in my life I almost died was the day I was born. I was born in a small town called Bremen, Indiana. A little farm community, much like Nebraska. I never bring up Indiana. I don't know why. I guess it's because every time I've ever said, hey, I'm from Indiana, there's always some guy in the crowd going, Indiana, I'm from here too. You know. And usually we're related. So keep it to myself. But I was born in Indiana, but I was conceived in Germany. My father was in the service and was stationed in Germany. At the same time, Elvis was there, but my dad didn't get nearly the publicity because he couldn't grow sideburns. But anyways, my mother went out to visit my dad in Germany. And these are two young kids from Indiana, hicks, farm kids, that were from Indiana, were in Germany, and apparently couldn't find anything interesting to do in Germany, what with the Bavarian Alps getting in the way of the view. And so they decided to make me. And so even though I'm from Indiana, technically, I'm German. Which is why growing up as a baby, I could only eat strained bratwurst. And as after looking at you people, it's obvious to me you're inferior. But it's a German joke. But when I was conceived, my mother did a very evil and devious thing. My mother said these words to God. God, if you will give me a son, I promise to dedicate his entire life to your service. Without asking me, my mother committed my life to God. Interesting thing about God, Pastor. When you commit your unborn child to God, he takes you seriously. Giving your unborn child to the Father forever is like being made in the mafia. God doesn't let you out until he kills you. And so, when it was time for me to be born, I was a breech baby. Face down, feet first. I had locked my feet into my mom's uterus, and I was hanging onto that umbilical cord like a ski rope, because apparently I wasn't as excited as she was to come out and start my ministry. And I almost died. And so did my mom. But she lived, and I lived. Why? Because I believe that when my mom made that prayer, at that moment, I was conceived for a purpose. At that moment, God knew what territory I was going to encounter, what people would come into my life, what type of personality I would have, what kind of package he was going to create to deliver his message. At that moment, I had been called to Nineveh. And if you're a follower, so are you. You have a specific meaning and purpose for your existence until he's done. I didn't know, couldn't possibly know, that comedy was going to be the way I was going to do this. How could I know that? But when I was in kindergarten, I wrote my first joke. The teacher decided that we were going to have a puppet show, and she asked for volunteers, and I volunteered, and another kid did too, and we got behind the stage. There was no script. We just put on our little puppet, stuck it up here, and we were supposed to go to town. And I was excited, and this kid was soiling himself. So I took the bull by the horns, and I said this, hey, let's play hide and seek. You hide, and he did, and I did this as a kindergartner. 1, 2, 4, 36, 55, 109, and the kids were rolling. Why? Because there's nothing funnier to a kindergarten kid than the old look, I don't know how to count routine. And I heard them laughing, and I felt the joy that I brought laughter to some kids, as though this is what I was destined to do, as though I had been called. And I walked out with my chest out, big, realizing that I had set the bar high. I was the puppet master of kindergarten. I say that because God, who gifts us specifically, does not allow you to spend your gift on you, which is the downfall of so many believers. We take our gift and spend it on us. And God treasures his gift. God will never allow your gift to trump his grace. And so, the next week, they decided to have another puppet show. And I raised my hand because I knew they gotta pick me, because nobody can compete. But she picked two of her people. And I remember actually thinking in this very haughty way, I can't wait to see the wheels come off of this train wreck. Now that they know what true puppeteering looks like. And I watched in horror as the two kids behind the screen said this. Let's play hide and seek. 1, 9, 15, 3. And the kids were rolling. And I remember thinking, that's my bit. Do you understand? I wrote my first joke in kindergarten and had it ripped off a week later. Welcome to show business. At that time, that was a good time to be alive. It was a small child in a small town, but there was some problems. I would come outside sometimes and see my mother crying. There were times when I didn't understand where my dad was. Of course, when you're a child in kindergarten, you don't understand what a mistress means. Or divorce. And the pain of watching those who represent God on earth leaving you and abandoning you is very difficult to reconcile as a child. And I would pray that God would restore my family. And miracle upon miracles, my friends, there was a point when my father came to me and said these words, "We're going to remarry again." The words that so many kids have prayed happened for me. We're going to remarry, and then we're moving to California. And we did. And it was on that fateful September in a Protestant church at the Orange Circle in Orange, California, that I raised my hand in Sunday school and said, "Yes, I will accept Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior." At that point, I committed myself to Him for the rest of my life as though I had been ordained, as though I was supposed to go to Nineveh. And I started my journey, this time willingly. This time I became a slave on purpose. But I was young. And when you grow up in the church, you know God for a long time makes for a real boring testimony. How I longed for the testimonies I used to see come up on these stages. Because I was 9. I found myself coveting other people's sinful testimonies, which I think for a Christian is 2 cents. They would say things, and I would want to be participating. "Yes, I used to be addicted to heroin, and the Lord freed me." And I'd be like, "Oh, if I was addicted to heroin." That's a great testimony. "I was a prostitute, and the Lord freed me." "Oh, I could have done that." I was 9. I had to embellish my testimony. "Yes, I used to have difficulty with long division. And the Lord freed me from my mathematical shackles." "Yes, I used to only be able to ride a girl's bike growing up. But the Lord healed me from my gross motor skills delay problem issue." Because when I was growing up, they had a thing called the boy's bike and the girl's bike. I don't know if you know the difference. Girl's bike is like a normal bike, but it's got a big slot out so you can slide right in. Boy's bike is like that, except it has an iron bar. Welded under the seat, directly into the frame. The first time you took that bad boy out for a ride, there was no ambivalence about what your gender was. Because the first time your foot slipped off the pedal, you knew you were a boy. And it made no sense to me that a man would be so vulnerable by a God who created him, that organs could be put into vulnerable areas. What am I just talking to church? Loins. My loins is what I'm talking about. That's in the Bible. Sorry. Deal with it. Never made sense to me. And then I finally read the Bible and figured it all out. Because every other organ in a man's body, his heart, his liver, his spleen, protected by his rib cage. One went wrong, nothing went wrong. The one rib he took to make you is one protected my loins. That's what went wrong. And God said, "Feareth noteth." What dost thou mean, Lord?
"I've cursed the womaneth as welleth.
Inneth whateth waith, I haven't noticed that it itth at alleth." I always speak to the Lord in King James. You know, so he'll understand me.
"I've altered their hand-eye coordination."
I've never, "Oh, you mean like when they're throwing the ball."
"No, but that is funny." "From henceforth, women cannot apply eye makeup without opening their mouth."
I grew up in California and enjoyed my life. It's so simple when you're young. Mom and dad teaching you life. Family is there. only to find that one fateful day when my father took me into the bedroom and said, "We're getting divorced." And for the second time in my life, everything that I held dear, everything that held on to me and let me know that life had purpose and that I would always be watched and looked over, was taken from me. I have much more to this story, but we don't have time. Other than this, there's going to come a time in your life, my friends, when your parents aren't going to be able to fulfill those needs, when your friends aren't going to be able to fulfill those needs. You may have never had the father you deserved. You may never have had the mother you deserved. It's not fair, but it's what you got. You see, followers of Jesus believe that we were once perfect and we failed. That sin came upon the earth and it brought a cancer. Where suddenly my commitment to that one woman who God gave me suddenly becomes a desire for all women. Where my commitment to my family as a man and as a father and as a woman and as a wife to make sure that I give a good citizen to society is thrown away to the desires that I have where I no longer feel in love. Where my commitment to Christ and to God's commitment to me to say, "Follow what I tell you, son. You can have it all, but not that tree." And then we brought sin into the earth. And now we look at a culture in America where God says, "You can only have this." And we said, "No, we want it all." There comes a moment where you have to go and grieve what you did not get and let God come take you home. Let Jesus come back to you to that place in your life and say, "It's okay, son, you made it. You're an adult now. It was hard and it was painful, but I got you through. Let's go back and find that little boy and tell him you're going to make it, son. You're going to get there." Healing can come. Redemption is yours. Because, my friends, this is just the bridge to forever. Why do we hang on to this life like this is where the answers are? This is where we're supposed to tell the answers to those who are traveling to eternity with us. Why do we hang on to something we can't keep? Why do we try to hang on to something that was never ours? We gave it away. Christians are supposed to redeem culture. They are supposed to look at us and see that we do things differently. Not because we hate, but because we believe God made rules and we have to abide by them. And I walk with you along the way because I'm not perfect. I'll screw up. That's why it's called amazing grace. True Christianity does care about culture. True Christianity doesn't talk about Jesus. You become Jesus. I got kids out there that I represent from World Vision who have nothing. They don't have a net to put over themselves when they go to bed at night so a little mosquito will kill them. They don't have clean water that we can get any place we want to anywhere. Our homeless people have clean water. They don't. They dig wells for them. They teach them gifts and crafts so they can actually have the dignity of work. They don't expect to be given things. They expect to be given the opportunity to make a way for themselves like God told us to do. And many of them who are from Africa's parents have AIDS. And they are not going to have anyone to watch over them. And as we sit in rich America, you have a chance to be a missionary and not even have to go anywhere. Just for $35 a month.
You can sponsor a child, take him home, stick it on your refrigerator, and every time somebody walks into your house and says, who's that? You say, that's somebody I love because they're made in the image of God. And I send them a check once a month to make sure that they will grow up knowing that they are loved, they are dignified, and they are worth something. This is what Christianity is. It works in real time. Because if you want to know what you believe, my friends, it's simple. Does it affect your behavior? Because if it don't, you don't believe it. So please go out there and sponsor a child. It's $35 a month. Well, you're just making us feel guilty. I don't do that. The only reason people feel guilty is because they are. Christians have a word for it. Conviction. It's another echo that God says, do this thing and see what I do for you. We have to answer. I also have some DVDs out there where I lift up God and country and no cursing. But listen, if you don't have the money, just take care of a kid. I'll eat tomorrow. I'm okay. But if you're loaded, God would say, sponsor a child and then buy everything I have. Because my kids get hungry too. They wait for me at the door like a Dickens novel. Father, did you go to Omaha? Did they buy the DVDs? There comes a moment in a human being's life where they have to decide, am I going to believe in God and commit my life to Him? You don't have to. But in Christianity, if you do, you become a slave. You're bought with a price. You're not yours anymore. So God said, do not come to the cross if you're not serious, because this is very valuable. Count. You don't get to choose where God sends you if you believe in Him. You might have to change some of the ways you see life if you follow Christ. You might have to leave certain relationships that He asked you to because you believe in Christ. It's a big cost. And what He pays you with is perfection for eternity. To know the God we lost a long time ago. And He walks with you like a father and says, I will never leave you or forsake you. You have found your Creator. You've come home. If you'd never known that Jesus Christ was God and died and rose again, if you didn't know that happened, it did. One time in history, God came to this earth to prove Himself. He did an impossible thing to prove it's not a cult, but in fact is the one religion that is true. Because He did a miracle to say, I transpose natural. I'm God. If you believe that Jesus died for your sins, you will be His forever. Your sins will be forgiven, and you will start a road where you'll fall, you'll make mistakes, but you will get up, clean off, and walk with a bunch of brethren like from this church who will say, let's walk together. Let me carry some of that burden for you. Welcome to your family. Let's bow our heads. Lord God, I don't know why you would ever use me to do anything, because I'm an idiot. I thought I was just going to be a comedian. And you said, when you gave yourself to me, I decided who you were from then on. When you gave yourself to me, the gift that you have, the passion that you have, the desires that you have, will now be given back to me so I can direct you. to tell my story. Here's what I know. 50 years from now, 100 years from now, everybody that's listening to this will be dead. You won't be here anymore. Neither will I. And then you'll know. Am I in the presence of God? Am I His child? Did I find my Father? Finally. Today is a choice. But I'm a sinner, you might think. You don't know what I've done. You don't know what I feel. You don't know what I've created. You don't know the murders I've done, the adultery, the drugs, the alcohol. You don't understand. Why would God want me? And God says, oh, bring all those things to the cross. I died for them a long time ago. I've got the greatest news you'll ever hear, my friends. Today, you can be free. If you believe for the first time in your life that Jesus Christ is God, I want to pray with you. I'm a comedian. You saw what he used. He uses me. I'm nobody. I want you to know what love is. You've never accepted Christ as your Savior and would like for the first time to know and be a completed human being, I'd like you to raise your hand so I can pray with you. If this is your day to know the Creator, please do that. We'll pray with you.